Sunday of Easter, the order of worship was sent by email yesterday morning, or you can find it on our website at www.stjohnsredbud.org. It is under the media and the bulletin tab for this date. Our opening hymn, Lutheran Service Book, is hymn 483, With High Delight, Let Us Unite, 483.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins,
forgive you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We sing together the intro from Psalm 133.
Thank you.
appointed for this third Sunday of Easter is recorded in the second chapter of the book of Acts in the New Testament. But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and give ear to my words. Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified." Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" And Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children, and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself." And with many other words he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, "Save yourselves from this crooked generation." So those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We speak responsibly to gradual. Christ has risen from the dead.
God the Father has crowned him with glory and honor.
He has given him dominion over the works of his hands.
He has put all things under his feet.
The epistle reading is recorded in the first chapter of the first letter of Peter in the New Testament. "And if you call on him as Father, who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last times for your sake, who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart, since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding Word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And this word is the good news that was preached to you." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We sing together the Alleluia in verse. Who does not know the things that have happened there in these days? him concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back, saying that they had even seen a vision of angels, who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, Stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent. So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures? And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, The Lord has risen indeed, and has appeared to Simon. Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We join together in the common confession of our Christian faith and make use of the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We continue with our hymn of the day. It is hymn 476, Who Are You Who Walk in Sorrow, hymn 476.
Thank you. Today's message is based on the gospel reading we read a few moments ago, and continue with the sermon prayer. It's printed in your bulletin. We pray. Most gracious Father, may the words of my mouth
and the meditation of our hearts
be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. When Paul was dictating one of his letters to the church of Corinth, the Holy Spirit inspired him to make a short list of people who were alive and able to see Jesus after he had died and risen from the dead. Paul says, "For what I received, I pass on to you as first importance, that the Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day, and that he appeared to Cephas, and then to the 12, and after that he appeared to more than 500 of my brothers and sisters at the same time. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me also." Now these words remind us again of the hundreds of people who saw Jesus alive after he had risen from the dead. Now these accounts, of course, are not the modern, if you will, sightings of UFOs or Bigfoot. These, of course, were accounts of people who were indeed able to converse with our Lord, as well as be able to touch him and even eat with him. Many questions arise, though, when we read these accounts of the resurrection in the Bible. And one question that we might want to consider, or some would consider, is simply why? Why are some accounts included in God's Word, but others are not? The Apostle Paul tells us that there were many accounts of our risen Savior. I think the point is that the Holy Spirit is the one who inspired men to write specific events of our Savior's life that is, again, assure us that we are indeed forgiven. Our salvation is also free. Now, Jesus has done everything necessary for us to be free from the condemnation of God's holy law. Again, the Holy Spirit told Luke simply to write down today's gospel lesson, what he wants you and I to know here today. Now, Luke's account of the resurrection begins with the women who went to the empty tomb that first Easter morning. Luke tells us about the two men also, though, who were returning home to Emmaus after they had been spending time in Jerusalem celebrating the Passover. Now Luke talks about Jesus appearing to the disciples as they gathered in the upper room behind locked doors. He tells us also how Jesus spent 40 days after his resurrection appearing to more than 500 people before he finally ascended to heaven. There is a common thread, if you will, that runs through all the accounts in God's Word. The women, of course, were greeted by the angels when they had reached the empty tomb. Again, the angels told them, "He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee. Now the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words, on the third day he would be raised again. In today's gospel, we again hear our Savior tell the two disciples traveling with him in Emmaus, and he says to them, "How foolish you are and how slow to believe. All the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" Now we go on to the third account that Luke includes. He goes on and says, in the third resurrection account, Jesus appeared to the disciples and he said, "Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened up their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them simply, "This is what is written, the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead, and on the third day, repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem." In this particular account, Jesus, of course, is telling us to stay focused, keep our lives focused on God's word. You might remember that the angels pointed the women to the word of God that Jesus had just spoken. Jesus had also told the two disciples as they were walking along the road in the search for God's word, he simply said again, focus on Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. Now today, the gospel tells us that Jesus did this in his own identity, that is, from the two disciples as he began to walk with them to Emmaus. And he explained to them the scriptures. Luke tells us their eyes were kept from recognizing him, though. Jesus wanted them, and this is the key, Jesus wanted them to understand resurrection is based on God's promise and not what they could see with their eyes. God promises that we are saved by Christ alone, and nothing else is necessary, because Christ fulfilled it all for us. And our faith is not based on what we see, it is based on the gift of God and what God has done for us. Remember it. It is a gift that is not earned by us. The Holy Spirit, of course, is using the Word of God to help us understand that the resurrection of Christ is for our benefit. Now, Jesus said to his two disciples, yet, who could not figure out what they were trying to understand in God's Word, he simply said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and enter his glory?" Well, how would we react, if you will, if Jesus came to our home and started talking to us about our faith? Would he say the same thing to us as well that he said to the two disciples? "How foolish you are, how slow to believe all that you have learned." We might be surprised at how foolish and slow that we are to believe and understand God's word at times. It's very difficult. In fact, it's impossible for us to understand that without the Spirit revealing it to us. We would rather trust our own intuition and our advice of our friends and what is norm in our society than trust the word of God. For us, what the people say around us seems to be more understandable. Why is Jesus, though, then so persistent that we remain in God's word? Remaining in God's word is simply this: read it, hear it, learn it, memorize it, understand it. And understanding, again, is only comes through the work of the Holy Spirit. Now, why does he want us to believe what God has said to us? Simply because he wants us to understand that we are saved by grace through Christ alone. Jesus is insistent that we remain in God's word, again, because the power of God is given, tells us about our salvation, it reveals it to us. Now God, of course, goes on and says that the Holy Spirit gives us the gifts of his grace. Jesus is the Word that has been made flesh, meaning that he became human being like us. It is through the Word and the sacraments, again, that the Holy Spirit remains within us. Now every time we open up God's Word, it is God alone who is speaking those words to us. He speaks to us and gives us faith to believe that, again, we are saved by faith, grace, and after the gift of faith alone. It is our very nature, though, unfortunately, that for us to ignore God's word or to hear it without listening to it. We are, after all, still sinners in need of God. when we hear that our sin has caused the fallen world that we are living in, and our evil vices continue to create the mess that we have made in our lives. Our human nature desperately desires for us to make things right, though, to find a way back to paradise on our own. It makes sense that, again, to us that good, loving people go to heaven, but the others simply are sent to hell. It makes sense to us that we should be able to improve our life, that is, our moral behavior, so that we alone can make ourselves worthy of heaven. Therefore, when God's word tells us that we are cruel, evil, that we cannot save ourselves, we cry and ignore it and do it our own way still. And when God's word tells us that Jesus took the blame and the punishment for our cruelty and our evilness, we respond again sometimes, well, that's simply too good to be true, and insist that there's something else that we must be doing in order for us to earn our salvation. But we cannot. Jesus taught the Emmaus disciples, you see, that the entire Old Testament is about him. He showed them how the Old Testament proclaimed his suffering, his death, his resurrection. Jesus taught them that there is a single theme that runs through the whole Old Testament, through all of God's Word. It is a scarlet thread, if you will, winding its way through the very Word of God, the passages of Scripture. That scarlet thread is Christ himself, who comes to us again to assure us that in him, through his blood, his precious blood, we have been washed clean of all of our sin. There is absolutely nothing, anything we can do to earn that salvation. He is giving it to us for free. He wants us to understand that we can be at peace, his peace, for he again was crucified and risen to forgive all sin. It is through Christ Jesus that we have an eternal home in his kingdom. In our Savior's name, amen. And may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Continue with our next hymn, 474, Alleluia, Jesus is risen.
Thank you.
We join together in the prayer of the church, remembering those listed for us under healing and comfort, and those who serve in our nation's military. We do also continue to pray for those suffering from the coronavirus and its effects on our society. And we pray for those who work the land and tend the livestock as the planting season begins. We join together in the prayer of the church. You have heard our pleas for mercy, O Lord, and given up your Son to be our Savior. Hear us now as we come to you on behalf of ourselves and all people according to their needs. Our hearts have burned in us, O Lord, as your word has been read and preached. Keep our faith from growing cold, and grant us grace, that we may not waver in faith or succumb to temptation. Give to us and to our children receptive hearts, that we may hear, and hearing believe, and believing be steadfast in this faith and hope all our days. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You have cleansed us, O Lord, with water and the word and baptism, and you have marked us as your own people. Give to us grace that we may live out this faith and holy lives, lifting up your name in word and works for as long as we live. Guide us that with souls purified by obedience to the truth, we may love one another earnestly from a pure heart. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless your church, O Lord, that she may welcome the stranger in Christ's name and manifest the unity of the faith and the bonds of love. Gather together those who are separated and preserve their faith by your word until all precautions and shelter measures have passed. Bless our Senate President, our District President, our Circuit Visitor, and our pastors. Bless those training for church work vocations. Bless each of us as we live out our baptismal vocation of worship, witness, prayer, and service. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Guard our nation, O Lord, that we may enjoy peace and security in the face of threat and danger. Bless our President, the Congress of the United States, our Governor, and all state and local officials, that they may fulfill their offices faithfully. Bless all emergency and medical workers and the members of the armed forces who protect us. Through all of this, teach the nations of the world the ways of peace and justice. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Deliver us from all afflictions and grant us strength to bear all our burdens, O Lord. Hear us in particular for Floyd Lautenschlager, Kenny Tester, C. John Kringy, Ed Buffman, David Ebert, Gary Moeller, Larry Evers, Stuart Lungwer, Pam Stelmar, Roger Kozora, Lori Reese, Lori Moges, Brenda Manning, Cheryl Sanders, Reverend John Okomsky, Jason Riffelmeyer, Tom Quinn, Robin Hayes, Rick Evers, Reverend Brian Downs, and those who remain in our hearts. According to your gracious will, heal the sick, relieve those who suffer, comfort the grieving, and give peace to the dying. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. Stay with us, O Lord, and be our strength and weakness and our hope in time of despair. Your gracious will once kept the saints in faith, even unto death. Keep us, we pray, with them in your faith and fear, that we may be found faithful when Christ comes again in his glory, bring to fulfillment all things once and forevermore. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Through the breaking of the bread, O Lord, you forgive our sins, strengthen our faith, build up our unity as a congregation and synod, and equip us through this communion to love you and love one another as you have loved us. Preserve our faith as we wish to receive the sacrament in the presence of the congregation, but for now cannot, and grant that our desires soon will be fulfilled. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless, O Lord, those who work the land and tend the livestock as the weather warms, the daylight lengthens, and the time has come to plant a crop for harvest in the fall. We pray for weather that is favorable, for equipment that is dependable, and for the strength necessary for the job that needs to be done. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. Accept, O Lord, the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving we bring. Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Bless the Lord, since you have caused all the Holy Scriptures to be written for our learning, grant that we may so hear them read, mark, learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our closing hymn is hymn 488, He Has Risen, Glorious Word. Services Sunday morning at 9 a.m. We wish you God's blessings upon this day.